begin in Allah's name, the Beneficent, the Merciful. And everything we do should be around Allah and Tawheed, that we must mention Him and His presence and His will. Allah says, فَإِيَّايَ فَرْحَبُونَ, speak about me. And we must only speak about Allah. When we talk about the Prophets and Ahlul Bayt and the events of Karbala, please know it is all about Allah. Sometimes we forget that. As a society, we put too much emphasis on people. While they are direct representatives of Allah, the objective of those representatives is to take us to Allah. For that is crucial. And if we don't do that, and we become very much stuck on personalities of people, then we will miss the very essence of those people, because the principles of wilaya, which is leadership, guidance, protection, is predicated on the very principle of principles, which is to take us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reason many of us fail in our transactions in life, though we're religious, we're prayerful, we go to Hajj, we go to Ziyarat, yet sometimes within a short span, we drop it all for shaitan, if the deal gets better from Iblis. When you study what happened in Karbala, you'll find that Yazid and his cronies went and started bribing very key figures that were instrumental in protecting the religion of Islam. And they started to bribe them with money and gold and wealth. And of course, initially they all refused. Even Umar ibn Sa'd, you know, his father was Sa'd bin Abi Waqqas, was a famous companion, you know, in Medina. Just think about it. This is his son, a tyrant who's leading an expedition to go kill the very family of the Prophet, when his father was the companion of the Prophet. I mean, when you study some of these companions who became the caliphs illegally, with all due respect to all schools of thought, without any jurisdiction from God, you will find that Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. These were people who were around the Messenger of Allah. They saw the miracles. They saw him receiving revelations. His predictions came true. He was a man of ultimate wisdom. I mean, it's impossible to escape the impact of an agent of God, particularly Rahmatul Alameen. And that you find that your heart still remains, you know, ambivalent or agnostic towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when the Messenger of Allah is standing next to you. This nifaq, this hypocrisy, comes as a result of people worshipping personalities and not understanding principles. These people were around the Messenger of Allah, but the material aspects, the utilitarian aspect, the Machiavellian idea that the end is not justified by the means, which means that I can cheat and lie and steal, but if I can get the objective of becoming rich, then let me do so. In Islam, such principles are forbidden. For the Messenger of Allah could certainly have taken Mecca. They were ready to give him the keys, right? On the condition that one day he preaches his Tawheed, the next day he allows idolatry. He said, if you put the sun in my hand and the moon in the other hand, I will not stop preaching Tawheed. So why did he just not become a Trojan horse and get into the Kaaba and then convert the people towards Islam? Because you don't achieve virtue through vice. You cannot commit a haram act to promote a wajib or a halal act. So the principle here is that when we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the cause of all causes. It is Allah who has brought forth this universe. It is His mercy. And Allah tells us in the Quran, كَتَبَ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Indeed, I have made upon myself mercy obligatory. Imagine, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling me that He has made mercy obligatory in Himself. كَتَبَ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِ الرَّحْمَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling me, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِ عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. When my believers ask you about me, in this verse, by the way, Allah repeats in the singular I seven times. Seven times, I. It is the most powerful verse of the personal relationship of God to his creation. When he makes this sentence, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When my believers ask you about me, indeed I am near. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. I reply them when they ask me. Many of us say, well, we ask God, I didn't get the reply. Allah replies everybody. And by the way, you say, well, I have to be very pure, you know, without any haram for Allah to reply me. Not true. Not true. The disbelievers who are impure asked God for guidance, and Allah guided them, and they became believers. So how did they become believers when they were not believers? For Allah answers all. أَدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. There is no condition in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's principle when it comes to him responding to his creation. And Allah will never reject that which he created with ultimate beauty and by ignoring it. Not at all. Allah rejects and ignores when that being who has been given limited free will decides to reject Allah continuously. في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا. In their hearts is a disease, therefore Allah increased the disease. How? By Allah saying, since they don't want me, they're rejecting me, then I'm going to let them go. And by me letting them go, their disease will increase. That's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. So principally, please understand, within these nights of conversations and every night, that when we come here and commemorate, the nawhas were recited. What were they for? We talk about the event of Karbala, and then we talk about the water, and in the nawha you talk about how Abbas alayhi salam spoke to, you know, his niece Sakina, and that she says, you know, Abbas Amujan, in Farsi they say, right? That I'm thirsty, Alatash. And you find that Abbas feels that conversation, you're feeling it, you're crying about it. Imam Hussein is doing something, the women are doing something. It's in the nawha, these eulogies that we recite. What are they for? To invoke in us that spirit of justice, the spirit of subservience to Allah, the spirit of sacrifice towards Allah, the desire for somebody when you say, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, say, my prayer, my sacrifice, my life and my death are all for Allah. Well, what do you mean by this? My prayer, my sacrifice, my life, my death. What do you mean? Go to Karbala. Go to the Imams. Go to the stories of the Prophet, the Prophets. Allah is constantly, you see, He's telling us, right? وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مُوسَى. Remind them in the book about Musa, when he did this. How about Maryam? ذِكْرُ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّكَ. Zakaria, and then Maryam. So on. Why is Allah taking me to these personalities? It is to prove these principal points, which is that it is nothing but for Allah. So when we admire personalities, everyone, all 124,000 prophets, the 12 a'imma, and the extended family of the Holy Prophet of the Ahlul Bayt, those who became martyred in Karbala, what were they doing? قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That was all they were doing. They were completely sacrificial for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing more to speak about. When Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهِ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, Allah has purchased from the believers their selves. They fight, they kill, and they're killed for me. And here the fighting is not with a sword or with a gun or with a bomb. Fighting day to day on a daily basis to promote good and forbid evil and to prevent lying and to speak honestly and to love and to care and to share and to give and to forgive. That's what it means. So I'm establishing this very, very important point, brothers and sisters. I've heard through the grapevine that Tawheed is not spoken much within the community. It disturbs me. Tawheed is the center of all conversations. And if in these gatherings and on these pulpits, Tawheed is not mentioned
as the most prevalent feature of this pulpit, then we're doing an injustice to ourselves. 100%. And I say this vociferously, meaning without any holding back, for I believe that these pulpits must promote Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yes, the extension of how Allah functions in the modus operandi is through the Quran, guidance, the Kaaba, Mecca, Medina, Holy Prophet, of course, central, Ahlul Bayt. Without them, there is nothing for us to do. There is no way. Allah said, وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَطْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِي وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ وَإِن كَانُوا مِن قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ He it is who sent prophets from among yourselves, أُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ What did the prophets do? They recited the signs to you. They showed you the signs. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ They purified you. They taught you the law. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ وَالْحِكْمَةِ And they gave you wisdom. And before this, you were in utter darkness. So I think it's extremely important for us to know, brothers, that no matter how we sit in these conversations, please, especially our young generations, we must instill tawheed. When I talk about Rasulullah and my love for Imam Ali alayhi salam, it's tawheed. You read the entire Nahjul Balagha. Often, when I speak, I try to follow the same framework in my presentations as Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. All his sermons, if you study them, they all started with the fadail, with the recognition of Allah's greatness, and to see how Allah functions in this spectacular universe, and to appreciate the mercy of Allah within the framework. Then the Imam would give us exhortations and tell us, do this, don't do this. I'm warning you, don't do that. This is what happened. This is how history is. This is what will happen in the future. But if you study the framework, Tawheed was always the framework first. Then the Hidayah came. That's true Hidayah. So I hope, inshallah, in these nights, within our communities, especially we, the Ja'fari community, the Shia Ithna Ashari community, the Twelver, I want you to know, we are the flag bearers of Tawheed. We get accused that we are too much attached to the Imams. It's false. It's not true. We're attached to the Imams because Allah loves them. It is Allah who told us to go there. إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَالرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا It is Allah uses the word wali here. If you understand Arabic, wali is mufrad. Mufrad meaning it's singular. Wali is singular. Allah is talking about three groups of people with a singular term, wali. He doesn't say إِنَّمَا أَوْلِيَاءُكُمُ اللَّهُ Allah says, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ It's in the Quran, verse 55 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, the fifth chapter of the Quran. Allah is telling us, the wali, إِنَّمَا وَلِيُّكُمُ اللَّهُ وَالرَّسُولُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Three groups, Allah, the Prophet, and those who believe, which is Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, and all the Imams that follow him. Three groups. Allah says, they are all one, same wali. They are one hand of God. So when we mention Ahlul Bayt and we go to their graves and we cry and we hold them, it is within the principles of Islam to do that. I've heard people tell me, no, but we should not be asking them for anything. I said, then you have not read the Quran. For in the Quran, in verse 97 of Surah Yusuf, after the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam realize they have sinned by the sin that they committed by throwing their young brother in the well with the hope that he will die, they realized that they were wrong. So they go to the father, Yaqub, who is a prophet of God, in the Quran, and they're telling him, you pray for us to God for forgiveness. It's in the Quran, verse 97. You pray for us, to Allah to forgive us. Yaqub didn't say, excuse me, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ You, we seek, and from you we, worship, and from you we seek. Yaqub alayhi salam could have told them, no, don't ask me, although he's a prophet of Allah. What does he reply? He said, Sawfa, I will do it, and I will ask Allah to forgive you. He didn't say, stop, don't ask me to pray for you. So in the Quran, you find even the companions of the cave, after the miracle of them waking up 300 years after, they built a mosque on their grave. It's in the Quran. A masjid was built as a sign of the miracle of Ashab al-Kahf. It's in the Quran. How do you build a masjid over a group of companions of the cave? And that becomes central to the worship of Allah. We don't worship them. They are the means by which Allah has sent us to understand Allah. That the wilaya, the shifa'ah, you see? When you look at Allah says, مَنْ ذَلَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِي. Who can intercede on my behalf except by my permission? يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءَ. That they have cannot avail themselves of any knowledge except that which we give them. But Allah is saying, they are my shifa. They are the ones I have appointed to become my intermediaries. Not that you worship them, but they are a means to me. So I understand that when we, the lovers of Ahlul Bayt, do this, it makes sense. It's logical. It needs to be. That when you visit the haram of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and you are touched by his presence and your heart is pounding, what is pounding? Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُولِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. The believers are those, when they hear the name of Allah, their hearts palpitate. See? وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. And when the Quranic verses are recited, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُ زَادَتْهُمْ, their iman increases because the Quran now strengthens them. So when we go to the Haram, you go to the Kaaba, you go to Safa and Marwa, the two hills that Hajar alayhi salam moved one to the other with her son, Ismail. These are, Allah says, Sha'air Allah. These are signs of God. And Allah says, keep an eye on them. They're sacred. Is that idol worshiping? Absolutely not. But we are the scions of Tawheed. I know when I debated Dan Barker the first time, it became quite well known among the communities of the other schools of thought that this debate started spreading very rapidly among them. And interestingly, one of those very ultra Wahhabi came to visit me. Quick story. I wasn't there. He entered Imam Ali Center in New York. He walked in, he said, I'm looking for this man, Rajab Ali, who debated this atheist. So the brother said, he's not here, but why are you here? He says, I'm extremely impressed with his tawheed. SubhanAllah. Salafi, who accuse us of worshiping other than Allah. What an irony. He looked around. He said, this is Imam Ali Center. Are you guys Shia? He said, yes. He said, Rajab Ali is a Shia? He said, yes. He said, Ajib. How come? The guy said, why? He said, I thought you guys don't worship God. He was very impressed. He left. I never met him. But I smiled. I said, not only are we talking to the atheists, but we're talking to the Muslims too. For Tawheed is so powerful that it touches everybody and it changes everybody's life because it brings them close to the centrality of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Salawat ala Muhammad. Even Luqman gives, what is the best advice? Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةِ أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَ. We gave, not only نِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَ, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةِ. Right? And Allah says, يُؤْتِ الْحِكْمَةَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَمَنْ يُؤْتَ الْحِكْمَةَ فَقَدْ أُوتِيَ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. We give wisdom to who we will. And when we give it, we give you a lot of good. Allah says that we gave it to Luqman. What was, وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِيَبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِذُهُ. He was giving him an advice. What's the first advice Luqman gave? Ya bunayya, la tushrik billah, inna shirka la dhulmun azim. My son, do not associate anyone with Allah. Shirk is a great dhulm. First advice. Then he says, Ya bunayya, aqim as-salah, wa'mur bil ma'roof, wanha 'anil munkar, wasbir 'ala ma asabak, inna dhalika min 'azmi al-umur. وَلَا تُسَئِرْ خَدَّقَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يحب كل مختال فخور. واقصد في مشيك واقضد من صوتك، إن أنكر الأصوات لصوت الحمير. واو، brilliant. If you understood what I just recited, brilliant. I mean, this should be ensconced on a wall for us to understand as an advice of a father to a son who has wisdom. But what is the centrality of his entire conversation when he's advising the son? Tawheed. So we are blessed, brothers and sisters. And when we talk about Imam Hussein, listen to his entire khutbah, even the khutbah that he gave, his last sermon in Arafat. Every station he arrived at while he's going towards Karbala, on the day of Ashura, 10 days before Ashura, listen to what he's saying constantly. Nothing but Allah, Tawheed Allah, Tawheed Allah. Telling the enemy, you have forgotten Allah. You have foregone from that. And do not sell your souls cheap, for whatever was thrown at you as bribes will not benefit you. For Imam Hussein alayhi salam looked at Umar ibn Sa'd. He said, oh Umar, you've been promised governorship of Ray, which is in Persia, today modern day Tehran. And Imam Hussein said, you will not only not enter that city, you will not eat the wheat from that city. You will leave this world before that. He looked at Ibn Ziyad. He said, he's building a white palace in Basra. He built a white palace in Basra, by the way. He was the only governor in the history of Islam who held two positions of governorship, Kufa and Basra. Because he was such a monster, they needed to use him in Kufa to subdue the uprising of the Shia. The Shia of Ali were the strongest in Kufa. And Sarjun had advised to his father, Muawiyah, that if you ever have a problem with Kufa, send Ibn Marjana, because he's such an illegitimate, hopeless, absolute enemy of God with two legs. I'm paraphrasing. Use him, because his viciousness is bar none. And Imam Hussein says he won't live in that palace one day. Historians tell us that as soon as Karbala took place, the uprising started. That when Yazid started displaying the family of the Prophet, and this, by the way, is very powerful. This is exactly what Imam Hussein wanted. He wanted the power to penetrate the fortress of Shaitan and to come in it and to bring light to the community. When Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When he ascended that pulpit, what did he do? He was shattering Shaitan. When Zainab alayhi salam spoke to Yazid, what was she doing? She was exposing the evils of the Umayyad. The people of Syria didn't know. They thought this guy is good. Suddenly they looked at Ahlul Bayt. They said, my God, أَفَمَنْ كَانَ مُؤْمِنًا كَمَنْ كَانَ فَاسِقًا لَا يَسْتَوُونَ. You can't compare a mu'min and a fasiq. You cannot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Imam Hussein through his blood to penetrate into these enemy lines. But look at the effect of what happened, that while they were planning and dreaming in their fictitious ideas of building palaces on earth, Imam Hussein promised them that you won't live even one day. And soon thereafter, they were chasing Ibn Marjan. Ibn Ziyad was running away. He wanted to escape Basra. He didn't spend one night in the White Palace. They were looking for him. Historians say he hid himself under the belly of the camel. He tied himself under the belly of the camel in a caravan and escaped Basra to go to Damascus. So this was the man who was commanding Kufa like he was a god on a pulpit, beheading people indiscriminately. And now he's under the belly of a whale, belly of a camel. And he's now running like a chicken without a head. Allah says, look. So tonight, briefly, I want to touch. Tawheed is a central aspect, brothers and sisters. Two nights ago, I recited, وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِ. No, Allah manages between mankind and his heart. And Allah says, iman is in the heart. When we say, رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِقْ قُلُوبَنَا بَعْدَ إِذْ هَدَيْتَنَا. Our Lord, don't let our hearts go astray. But I want us to know there is nothing more real to us than a heart. Just the other day after my lecture, a brother came and hugged me.
And I just spoken about heart. And he hugged me, says, I just want to tell you from the bottom of my heart, I love you. And I smiled. I said, it's real. What he said is real. Because he brought the heart, not only the heart, but the bottom of it, the one that settles. So I want to give you from the bottom of my heart, I love you. That's beautiful. I want to have a heart-to-heart talk. You know, if I say to someone, let's have a mind-to-mind talk. You are crafty. You're not an honest man. You're tricky. I'm going to have a mind-to-mind. The mind. Let's have a mind-to-mind talk. Imagine you say to your wife, my mind loves you. She'll feel very sad. You say to your child, I've been thinking a lot. You're very handsome, very beautiful. I've concluded I love you. Just doesn't go. But the words are right. Yeah, but where did it come from? The manipulated organ that can change its mind whimsically? No, no, no. My heart loves you. In the Arabic, they say, Ya Habib Qalbi, or the love of my heart. That's unique. Allah is there. And what I love is that Allah is there. That's why it's so powerful. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِ Allah says, قَالَتِ الْعَرَابُ آمَنَّا In Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah says, the Arab dwellers say, we believe. قُلْ لَمْ تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا أَسْلَمْنَا وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَإِن تُطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَا يَلِتْكُم مِّنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ شَيْئًا Wow. The desert dwellers say we believe. Allah says, tell them they don't believe. Lam tu'minu. Rather say we submit. Islam is proactive. It's not a religion of theories and talk. It's the religion of practice and pragmatic relations. Karbala is practice 100%. Shahada is practice. Sacrifice is practice. Standing in front of a tyrant and pointing a finger at him with intrepidness like Zainab alayhi salam did and the way Imam Zainul Abidin did was practice. It wasn't theoretical. It was practice. It was an example for us to hold on, not theoretical. Aslamna. Imam Zainul Abidin says, we have done taslim. You see, فَعَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ Maintain your faces upright, right? But maintain your faces, Allah also says, bow down your faces towards Allah. Imam Zain al-Abidin bowed. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, they claim to believe. Tell them they don't believe. Tell them they submit. فَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانِ Iman has not entered your hearts yet. When you follow Allah, وَإِن تُطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ Now your iman has entered, then your deeds will remain intact. لَا يَلِتْكُم مِّنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ شَيْئًا It will count. So our hearts need to be cleansed constantly, please. We must ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All our transactions, brothers and sisters, I advise us all that the love we have for Ahlul Bayt must reside in the heart. Not with the tears or with the tongue. These come from the heart. Imam Ali said, مَا جَفَّتِ الدَّمُ إِلَّا لِخَسْوَةِ الْقُلُوبِ وَمَا قَسَتِ الْقُلُوبِ إِلَّا لِكَثْرَةِ الذُّنُوبِ Hearts don't give, eyes don't give tears. مَا جَفَّتِ الدَّمُ Until, when hearts are hard, tears don't come out. And Imam Ali says, hearts don't get hard unless they are filled with sin. When you are filled with sin in your heart, you cannot have real tears. The tears of Karbala, the tears of crying for the injustices of the world is true conversation to God. It doesn't need words because it translates into action. So I just want to stress this tonight within these few minutes that please, we must all look at ourselves and say, Ya Allah, how do I make my heart real? Forget my tongue. Forget my looks. Forget what I say. Forget what I see. Ya Allah, purify this heart and let it come from here everywhere else. That everything I say should come from my heart. I honestly say when we speak even on these pulpits, you know, you can be very articulate on these pulpits. You can be very impressive. You can be very poetic. You can use very you know, bombastic words and very fantastic words, and people like mesmer, oh my God. It means nothing. I promise you. It's the heart that should speak. Get on this pulpit or be with each other, in your family, in your business. You, my young brother sitting here, focus on your hearts. Be honest, sincere, and let your heart be true. When you have iman, keep it within that and watch. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ. I manage your heart. And whatever's in the heart is true. So tonight, when our hearts are purified and we really understand the conversation of the mercy of Allah and that advice Luqman gave to his son, maintain prayers, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, promote good, وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, وَنْهَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, forbid evil. وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ, be patient with the tribulations you will face. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ, this is a very elevated, very honorable act. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ مِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. وَلَا تُسَئِرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ, don't turn your face away from people. وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا, don't walk exultingly on earth in an arrogant way. وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا, indeed, God doesn't like arrogant people, people who show off. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. وَقْصِدْ فِي مَشِّكْ, lower your demeanor, become humble, balance yourself, don't be screaming and don't be agitating and don't have whimsical thoughts and don't fluctuate in emotions. Be balanced, be predictable. You're going to meet this person. You say, oh, he's very temperamental. I don't want to trigger him. I may say one thing and he'll throw stuff at me. Not that kind of a person. The kind that you know no matter when you meet them, how you meet them, like the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Was predictable. People say when we met him, we thought we knew him for life. He was always the first to say salamu alaykum. And he always paid attention and gave you eye contact. And he looked at you with such depth that he penetrated your heart. And you felt like you knew him all your life. And he would reach into your heart and massage you. That is rahmah. That is the mercy of a prophet. You and I should pray to Allah to have that character. When you study motivational speakers, what is it about them? You say, well, they've got energy. They're very energetic, very positive energy. And they do. They're smart. They know how to manipulate minds. But they're not the ones who touch hearts. The one who touches hearts is the one who has tawheed in them. The one who understands the message of Allah, knows the purpose of life, and sees the day of judgment like tomorrow. Allah says, إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. They see that day of judgment far, but we see it near. If you go, subhanAllah, if there is one thing that touches me the most about Karbala and the day of Ashura, was this talk. Every companion on the night, when they asked for respite to pray on the 10th night of Ashura, meaning before the day of Ashura on the night, you find that they ask Umar ibn Sa'd, that hold back, we want to pray. And as they were praying, each one knows tomorrow they will be massacred. They said, I will be before you. I'm going to become shaheed before you. So please, if I do, don't give up on Hussein alayhi salam, our master. Each one was advising. They all said, no, I'm the first one to go. If I could record this, this would defy the human consciousness today of materialism. That these are people who are so confident, like they're standing on the day of judgment seeing paradise. And they are talking like the day of judgment is now. Allah says, إِذَا وَقَعَتِ الْوَاقِعَ لَيْسَ لِوَقَعَتِهَا كَاذِبًا. When that event is coming, what will make you belie this date? A believer who has tawheed in their heart sees the day of judgment like today, tonight or tomorrow. Near. Now, I love this conversation because I'm thinking 14 centuries later, I want to survive this difficult trial on this earth. And I'm praying to Allah that I die a believer. I'm praying to Allah I die a Muslim. How do I make sure that I'm going to secure my iman before I leave? I may be standing on a pulpit, talking, doing philanthropic work, teaching children, you know, lecturing, doing da'wah, interfaith dialogue, but that means nothing
For the last minute, Shaitan can fool me and the next thing I'm gone. How do I strengthen myself with that level of yaqeen that even if Iblis were to send all the wealth on the earth, that I will just discard it? What sort of vision can I have such that I guarantee myself that level of yaqeen? It is to see the day of judgment like tomorrow. So when I listen to the companions of Karbala talking and they're saying, and in fact on the battlefield as they are bleeding, they say, for example, Muslim ibn Awsaja was becoming shaheed within a few minutes, right? Habib ibn Mudahir is holding him, removing the blood from his face. He says, "Oh Muslim, what is your last will before you leave?" On a battlefield. He said, "I see the Prophet. He's giving salams to you." He hasn't died yet, but he's already there. He's at the pool of Kawthar. He's already answering. You get it? He's sabiqun as-sabiqun, ulaik al-mukharrabun, fi jannati al-na'im. They're the foremost of the foremost. Paradise awaits them. But how did they get there? They said, well, they prepared themselves. And then when they put it into action, when the call came, it all clicked. And now the reality came. But that purification of the heart was central to this whole conversation. Okay? Even other companions, for example, if you look at all of them, the old ones to the youngest ones, if you study them historically, and I do a lot of that analysis in my historical studies, I find their hearts resonated with purity. And as soon as they were called, they jumped. Because innamal mu'minuna alladhina idha dhukira Allah wajilat qulubuhum. The believers are those when Allah is mentioned, their hearts palpitate. Salawat ala Muhammad wa al-Muhammad. There is much history I want to touch on, but I'm going to set this foundation, and then in the next few nights, as you know, we will talk about a few of the historical events. History is very important for us to understand the dynamics. But I find in the general population, reiterating history may not necessarily fulfill the objectives of true da'wah, because many people may not know how to extract the message of what happened in history. So such and such happened in history, but what does it mean? You have to describe it, explain it, and then juxtapose it with the centrality of the Quran to show the evidence as the central authority, the Quran. That's needed if you and I are going to guide each other closer to Allah when it comes to matters of history. So the foundation, one of them, Surah Ibrahim, verse 24. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةٍ كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. This verse, have you not considered Allah sets forth the parable of good word? Here, شَجَرَةٍ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says a good word. It's a tree, and Allah uses the analogy of a tree. Like a good tree, meaning the word is a good tree, whose root is firm, ثَابِتٍ, and whose branches are in heaven, yielding its fruit in every season by the permission of its Lord. And Allah sets forth parables from men that they may become mindful. These parables, daraba, right? Amthal, وَيَضْرِبَ اللَّهُ الْأَمْثَالَ لِلنَّاسِ. We have set forth parables for mankind to reflect on, to understand the dynamics of the trueness of what they are supposed to be doing in life. And you will see that those analogies are shown in our lives every day, as Allah says in the Quran, كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَأْنٍ. Every day there is a sign. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. Which of my bounties will you belie me for? These are signs. Now, when we look at Karbala, when we look at the prophets in Ahlul Bayt, they are the shajara, good tree. Imam Hussein alayhi salam shajara is so powerful that Fatima alayhi salam, salawat ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. When she saw that her right was being taken, her fadak was being taken, she was being abused, that right after the messenger's departure, so many negative things started showing up. The trueness of Iblis in their cloak, in their camouflage started to become unveiled, and they started to show the true fangs. And she was very, very disappointed that my father just left after having done all this good for you. And this is how you're responding with your, you know, absolute abject faithlessness. But in her faith, she said, what shall come forward through my children? shall be so firm and it shall grow with such power and might that it will take over the world. وَالَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. That it is going to overtake this hidayah. It's going to overtake. The event of Karbala was such a powerful tree that visually when you just examine, don't even go deep into it, and watch its power growing as we speak. It is very, very accelerating as we speak, especially when the enemy made mistakes in Iraq. The enemy was plugging Iraq for centuries, blocking the flourishing of the message of Ahlul Bayt. They were plugging it, and they made a seismic mistake in Iraq, and that's the sign of Iblis. Iblis makes mistakes all the time. And that mistake opened up a channel by which the lovers of Ahlul Bayt filled in quickly. It was an opportunity. And it's coming faster than we imagine. Allah says, وَنُرِيدُ أَنَّمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ. It is our desire, you oppressed ones, that you will become the inheritors and the leaders of society. This is a will that Imam Sahib al-Zaman, Ajrallahu ta'ala farajak, recited. As soon as he was born, Imam Hassan Askari alayhi salam held him in his lap. And as he is holding him, Imam Sahib al-Zaman recited, وَنُرِيدُ أَنَّمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. From Surah Al-Qasas, verse number 5, you will see that Imam Sahib al-Zaman was reciting this. What is this verse? It is the desire of Allah to make you the oppressed, the inheritors. And by the way, this is mentioned even in the biblical scriptures. The meek shall inherit the earth. It is mentioned in all scriptures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the reason I'm saying this is, while we're looking at the framework of Islam, we want to purify our hearts, we want to get close to Tawheed, we want to be good Muslims, we're also despondent sometimes thinking that the powers of evil forces are surrounding us, they're suppressing us, they're oppressing us. We feel very pressured. Allah says, don't worry. You want to understand pressure, then go to Karbala. You want to understand the release of pressure, then go to Karbala and after, and see the behavior of Imam Zainul Abidin post-Karbala in how he released the pressure and how he penetrated into the enemy lines and how he established this great tree that was already planted by Allah from Adam alayhi salam. You and I are also a tree. So let us not be spectators looking at this tree of Ahlul Bayt as a tree to be admiring for. For you and I are also trees. And this conversation is about how do I make my tree strong? How do I make my roots strong? How do I make my fruits strong? How do I take my branches to the sky? This is the key to the verse that I'm reciting right now. That the importance of taking this branch is high, which implies what? Meditation, reflection, cogitation, sacrifice, kindness, forgiveness. Islam is a practical religion. Our akhlaq is central to how the heart displays the beauty of this tree. If our akhlaq is not good, and we speak great about Islam, we speak great about Allah, we speak great about the Day of Judgment, and we speak with confidence, but our akhlaq is not good, it just doesn't make it. Allah says, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَا أَنفُسَكُمْ. You promote good to others and not for yourself? How? أَمْرَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهْيَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ was the will of Imam Hussein to his brother, Muhammad bin Hanafiyyah. If you look at it, when he leaves him that will and tells him that I'm leaving you my will, what was in the will? Imam Hussein alayhi salam says, I am commanded by Allah to promote good and forbid evil. And I am called to that, just like you and I. Allah says, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. Ta'muruna bil ma'aruf wa tanhawna anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. You're the best in the ummah. You promote good, you forbid evil, and you believe in Allah. So I'm touching this fundamentally. And I'm going to stress that this tree is the tree of what you and I are touching every day through these commemorations.
But please, for the love of Allah, let us just not touch the tree. Let us become the tree. It's extremely important. I am very depressed within our community when we have the best role models, the best history, the best guidance on earth, and yet we have bad behavior. We have foul tongues. We don't have sincerity and honesty. And I point this finger to myself first. And let us tawassaw bilhaq wa tawassaw bilsabr. So in conclusion tonight, you find historically that after Imam Hussein's shahad, after the dust settles, you notice that we are now commemorating 40 nights. I spoke about it yesterday in the outside, and I'll talk about it tomorrow in more details about the principle of 40, just a general principle, but as a secondary introduction, it means reflect, meditate, apply. Allah says, "Alladhina yadhkuruna Allah qiyaman wa qu'udan wa 'ala junubihim wa yatafakkaruna fi khalqis samawati wal ard." They do fikr, dhikr, of what? What Allah created. Why? Why that event? Why did the imam go? What was it for? And I know we've heard it thousands of times, but reminding is important. But the key to this remembrance of why the imam went is that we now accommodate that this event, which has such an impact on me, how do I take it and apply it to myself? Hence the 40 nights. That now we're going to reflect and discuss the gravity of what took place 40 nights ago. So Arba'een, for us, in the commemoration, people ask, why do you have Arba'een? Okay, you have Shahada of Imam Hussein, why Arba'een? Arba'een is for us to accommodate, to account for what we've done. It's very, very deep, very powerful. I don't have the time tonight. My time is running out. Just as an introduction, that reflection is for what? Purification of the heart. Once it sinks in to say, ah, I get it. Now what happens is my yaqeen starts to form, my certainty becomes better, and now my trajectory of my choices that I make in movements, in all my transactions, start to fit in correctly the way Allah wills. So when you look at history, Imam Hussein, after fighting and having been massacred, you find that the enemy suddenly started to show off, because the caliphate to them was a game. A little history here. The khilafah, which was supposed to go to Imam Ali alayhi salam from Allah, and please understand this, anybody who claims, and I'm repeating this, and I know it's being recorded, and I want the world to hear this, for the love of God, I'm sitting on a pulpit. Anybody who claims that the khilafah can be chosen by people don't know Islam. With all due respect, for there is not a single principle in Islam that allows such manufacturing. 124,000 prophets came. Some of them came to villages only for a family, yet not a single human being was asked to intervene to choose them. For Allah could have taught us at least and matured us over thousands of years to say, you humans get together and have some kind of a shura council so that you can choose somebody who will lead you. No, Allah says, not in my deen. Those of you who are presidents of your communities, when you choose them, you also have to look at them, hopefully that they are connected to this. What is this? Inni tarikun fikum al-thaqalain kitabullah wa itrati ahl bayti. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. We look at leaders and say, are you obeying Allah, the Prophet, the Quran, and the Ahlul Bayt? If you're not, you're disqualified as a leader. Even they, when we choose on a temporal basis, they don't represent the deen of Allah. They represent the in other words, they are holding and claiming to protect the religion of Allah. But that position is vastly different from the one I'm talking about as the wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we find in history is that why did Karbala take place? Because wrong leaders were chosen by people. And once that seat is taken over by a demigod, a person who Allah did not approve, they will start chopping the religion of Allah. So what did Yazid do in the first year? He killed Imam Hussein. Now, you know, when I listen to Christians talking, they talk about the donkey that Jesus rode, and they find a lot of sacredness in that. And the Christians have a lot of respect for that. And even the Christians will look at me and say, how did this man who claimed to be the caliph of God kill the very agent of God? Shaitan is laughing all the way to the bank. He said, look what I created. People say, radiallahu anhu. How do you say radiallahu anhu to a man who killed the Prophet himself? He killed the Prophet. The Khalifa killed the Prophet. And I'm saying it again. He killed the Prophet. Yazid, the Khalifa, killed the Prophet. Because the Prophet said, Husaynu minni wa ana min al-Husayn. Lahmuhum lahmi wa damuhum dami. He killed the Prophet. How do you stand there and Shaitan says, look, look, look. Because you chose and you did not obey Allah, look what I'm doing to this Khalifa. He's not only going to come and take religion out, he's going to kill the very people of religion. Then he burnt the Kaaba. He desecrated the mosque of the Prophet, put monkeys on a pulpit, put a turban on the monkey and put him on this pulpit, and they were laughing. And the Prophet said that. He was in Medina, Jibreel comes and the Prophet cries. They said, Ya Rasulullah, why are you crying? He said, Jibreel just informed me that as soon as I leave, within a short time, monkeys will be sitting on this pulpit with making fun of the religion of Allah. And it happened exactly. And then he burnt the Kaaba. The Kaaba. Inna awwala baytin wudi'a lin-nas alladhi bi Bakkatan mubarakan wa hudan lil-'alamin. So my God, in the annals of history, in any religion that I've heard, even the hypocrite has pretended to protect the religion. This one is blatantly chopping it. So that's why we are very adamant in understanding the leadership of Allah. That if leadership is wrong and we misdirect ourselves, we will kill each other. That is why when Adam was created, he was Khalifatullah. With qala rabbuka lil malaikati inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. I am going to place on earth my Khalifa, the first human being was the Khalifatullah. Tonight I end on this important point. This shajaratin mubarakatin requires leadership, requires divine leadership chosen by Allah, infallible leadership. We are blessed, the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we are blessed to have the finest leaders. We're blessed to have this. And when we commemorate their shahada, it should hit the heart the most. For everything we have in our universe is not comparable to these people. Honestly, I'm telling you, for Allah has mentioned it in the Quran. Nothing is superior in the eyes of Allah than those agents that He has loved and chosen. And if when you and I love them, and we shed tears for them, and we obey them, and we follow them, then we love Allah. Tonight, the pain of Imam Zainul Abidin and Zainab alayhi salam and Rabab and the other ladies that were present were imprisoned. As you know, they were taken from Kufa. First, they were humiliated in public in Kufa after Karbala. Zainab alayhi salam to watch all these strewn bodies of the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala laid without clothes, some of them, and watching that nobody's caring for them. That pain is unforgettable. When they reach Kufa, Ibn Ziyad starts to taunt them, starts to taunt Imam Zainul Abidin, starts to taunt Zainab alayhi salam. She stood intrepidly. He stood up and pointed a finger at him. That was the first rebuttal. But Zainab alayhi salam looked at the people of Kufa who were wailing and crying. She said, shame on you. My brother called you, but you didn't answer. What do I take from that? Me. I don't want to be like that. When Imam Sahib al-Zaman reappears and he calls me, I want to answer. I don't want to be that one who runs away. And no, yes, the Tawabin were good. The Tawabin, by the way, quick history, they rose and took revenge. Soon after, many different Tawabin groups rose. And there's a lot of history. If you watch that movie, Mukhtar, it's an excellent depiction of how the atmosphere was in Kufa. The confusion, but I want you all to understand, brothers and sisters, that these people witnessed our imams. They lived with our imams, yet they were so confused. What about us? If you and I are not struggling very hard to purify our hearts, what about us? The Tawabin rose and they killed Ibn Sa'd, they killed Ibn Ziyad, they killed Shimr, they killed Quli, they killed everybody. They were all destroyed. Eventually, they were all destroyed. But tonight, I just want to commemorate Ruqayya, known as Sakina. I really want our hearts to be feeling that tragedy, that as you know, Ruqayya was 4 years old, and she used to sleep on the chest of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. She was an elegant child. Those of us who have daughters, even sons, but daughters, when you hold them, when you caress them, they are a mercy of God. And I'm speaking as a father, that when I held my daughter, I saw the universe. I didn't understand womanhood. I didn't understand the female gender. But when I held my daughter, it just opened my eyes. Allah says, look at her, she's rahma for you, rahma. Hold her, she's your rahma. Imam Hussein held her this way. He kept her on his chest this way. That was how much rahma she was. Zainab was rahma to Imam Ali. She used to hold herself on his chest. When Imam was struck, she held him. She said, they have killed my father. They say when Ruqayya was in prison, there was no roof in the prison. The prison of Sham had no roof. It had four walls. So during the day, the sun would burn them. And during the night, the cold would freeze them. It was a very uncomfortable prison. But this little child missed her father. Now, I want you to understand that while she was traveling, she was seeing the head of her father. And I don't ever want to put a burden on any child in the annals of history to ever see their father's head on a spear. She's crying. Yazid is trying to sleep, that enemy of God. And he says, who is this baby crying? It's disturbing my sleep. The soldiers said it's the daughter of Hussein. So he says, then bring Hussein to her. Imam Zainul Abidin is in this prison. Rabab, the mother, is in this prison. Zainab is in this prison. They're trying to console this little girl from wailing. She says, I want my father. I miss him. Historians say the door opened up. And a tray was brought with a cloth on it. Please don't forget this. Put it in your hearts and in your minds. That this tray came, it was brought, and these prisoners looked at it. Imam Zainul Abidin knew what it was. Zainab knew. Even this little girl knew, but her love for her father, that even if there was one strand of hair she could touch, she would touch. So she goes towards that tray and she pulls that cloth. And then she looks at it and begins to cry and hugs it. And historians say that as she's hugging this little girl is hugging with her tender hands. She's hugging this head, caressing it, and having a conversation with her father. They say there was a deafening silence. The imam looks at her. Zainab and her mother is now waking her up. Ruqayya, wake up, wake up. There is no response. Ya ayatun nafsul mutma'inna irji ila rabbiki radiyatan radiyah. Oh, you purified soul, return to your Lord well pleased. She became shaheed and she was buried in that same prison in the corner, and Imam Zainul Abidin buried her in that prison. And when you go to Sham today, her grave was the prison. Allah la'anatullah al-qawm al-zalimin wa say'alamu alladhina zalamu أي منقلب ينقلب ماتم حسين.